we are. We're on. My name's Chris Gordon. I've been here before. Sounds crackly. Been here before. Must speak more quietly. I was here last Easter, and it was lovely to spend time together worshipping. And so I'll be here today and also next week while Stuart's away. So it's lovely to have you with us, and also those who might be joining online at a different time in the week, you're very welcome. Thanks for joining us. So over the next 2 weeks, we're going to be thinking about that call to follow Jesus, exploring what that meant for the first disciples of Jesus, and also therefore what it means for us in the 21st century. Because it can be hard at times to discern God's call upon your life, and yet God's promise is that he asks us to trust in him, to follow in behind him, anticipating his company and his comfort. And so as we come to worship him today, let's recall some encouraging words from the book of Deuteronomy, which says this: the Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid and do not be discouraged. So with that in our hearts, let's begin our praise as we sing hymn number 129, The Lord is King, Lift Up Your Voice. trainers being thanked, coaches and people helping with mental health as well. And then there'll be family at home that have made sacrifices. There'll be people that ferried young ones around in those early days, taking them to sports clubs all over the UK sometimes. And then those now that continue to support the families that are left behind sometimes. For someone to become a person of note in that sporting world, it takes an army of people behind them for them to flourish. And so while we might remember the name Andy Murray or the athlete Laura Muir, we acknowledge the unnamed people in the background who support them. Churches are no different. For a church to flourish, it requires teamwork. As people bring their different gifts and skills to serve God and the community. And some of those roles are really clear and obvious and visible, while others are less prominent but just as equally needed. And so we're thankful for all those that make this church flourish and other churches flourish. For those that clean or set up flowers. For those that pay the bills. For those that hold keys and allow access. For those that bring their musical talents and gifts of hospitality, for the prayer warriors and those who help with pastoral care. Everyone plays a part. While some roles are going to be more recognisable, God sees the heart of those that serve Him. And He's glad. So in this time of change and flux, as churches are linking, joining, seeking a renewed purpose, it may be that He's asking you to consider what your role could be. Maybe a role of prominence, maybe closer to the top, as we see in that picture. But you might be someone right at the base, providing that safe, strong structure so that a church can flourish. So whatever it is, whoever your role might be, you are a vital part of witnessing to God, of demonstrating His faithfulness as you step up and out, proclaiming your love and trust in Him as He takes us on these new journeys, which are exciting adventures. So a new journey involves steps, and we sing now together hymn number 530, One More Step Along the World I Go. about their day-to-day business, and then Jesus radically interrupts them, calling them to leave behind all that they know. And in doing so, Jesus gathers together a random group of people who, on the face of it, are ill-equipped to be missionaries. But Jesus calls them, literally, saying simply two words, follow me. He offers no explanation of where they'll be going and how long they'll be gone. He just asks them to recognize his authority and take those first steps of trust. And they do. And those actions have inspired many down through the centuries. See it most obviously in missionaries who have left lives behind to go and share the message of Jesus in far-off lands. And people still do that. Wonderful organisations continue to train and equip people to venture to new places and take risks for Jesus. So they remain a vital part of God's missionary plan in his world. Examples are rightly celebrated. It doesn't create a narrative that to follow Jesus can only be understood as sacrificially leaving something behind and travelling to new places. Because I think for the vast majority of us, that's something we haven't known or experienced.
Life of a disciple was full of uncertainty and challenge. It was
unsure of when their loved one would be returning, unsure of what their role was to be. So those that stayed, they were faithful too. Faithful to their marriage vows, faithful to the families they were left to support, faithful to the communities that they were integral to, and therefore faithful to God's own call upon their lives to follow Him. So we need to be just a wee bit wary of elevating one aspect of following Jesus above another, because following Jesus has different components to it, if you like. We can follow Jesus geographically, as the disciples did, as we know the Apostle Paul did, deliberately moving to a place that might be unfamiliar, with a view to taking that message of Jesus to new people. And there's a wave of that in recent years. Within the UK, people moving into areas specifically with a team around them to take a message. And it's known as incarnational ministry. And I've been blessed over the last 10, 15 years to know people who do that in different parts of Glasgow and beyond. And it's a wonderful act of faith, trusting that God will support them in challenging circumstances. You can also follow Jesus in attitude, having a heart to reach out to the lost and serve those on the fringes. And our volunteering and our giving can be manifestations of this. It doesn't require us perhaps to travel far as such, but using our home and our support network as the base from which to set out on whatever mission it is that God has called us to. Bringing them His kingdom values. I know within here and certainly within the local area, there's people that do that. As they help out in places like Glasgow City Mission and other places locally within this community. And then of course, vitally, we can follow Jesus spiritually. And that can be such an important thing, especially when our circumstances are such that venturing far from home, and sometimes even venturing out at all, is hard. And so our following Him manifests in our prayer life and in the support and encouragement that we're able to offer to others. Praying for and with others is perhaps the most important part of any ministry and mission. Act of fellowship. Those small words of encouragement, which can be shared either in person when you see someone, or in a message sent by phone, that can make a huge difference between someone feeling valued, continuing in their task, just being unnoticed, just thinking about giving them something. Circumstances. It's important to know that Jesus is aware who we are, the stage of life we're at, the things that we carry with us. He knew that for those first disciples. He challenges us in that. Following Him might make us or socially uncomfortable, but He won't ask anything that's beyond us. And His knowledge of us and our circumstances means that He uses all our experiences, positive, maybe even more helpfully, our negative experiences, to bring light into the world. He knows our skills, and He repurposes them for His kingdom. So as He says, follow me, at the same time He's saying, bring everything you've learned and experienced, because I'm going to use that. As evident today within that passage that Agnes read, as He infamously says to the fishermen, I will make you fishers. skills and repurpose them for something different, for a kingdom purpose. And that still happens. I know that because not too far from here is a company that roasts coffee, offering at the same time an opportunity for people with their own previously acquired skills. That's a very specific example I've given you, but the hope is that it demonstrates that God can use each of our life experiences, whatever they might be. Yours will be specific to you. Your journey is unique, and God can use it as a light for others. So perhaps it's the perseverance that you've shown in trying circumstances. Perhaps you'll use the willingness you've shown to volunteer, to serve. Perhaps it's the business or strategic skills you've acquired in your life, or the supportive, administrative roles that you've had. It'll definitely be your reliance on prayer to get you through challenging situations. Because what's unavoidable is that Jesus calls us to follow him. He calls us to a task. And that task requires our commitment and our sacrifice. In the context of Killearn, perhaps an avenue for this will be how the new linkage with Strathclyde is going to work out in practice. And the opportunities that it gives for shared outreach and shared mission. So as that new gospel partnership develops, we can each ask ourselves, experiences has God placed in my path before can be used this way? What skills have I acquired can be repurposed? Because the only option that isn't available to us seem like the church is getting smaller. In some ways it is. Medically it is, that's not wrong. That doesn't mean God's not working. God's not sowing little seeds and sustainable into the lives. So this passage here that we've read isn't a passage for someone younger. Isn't this a passage for someone with less ties? It isn't a passage for someone who's maybe considered more evangelical than me. This call to follow is inclusive, not exclusive. And then as we Jesus' style of ministry and mission. His reliance on prayer, his need for rest, his setting of boundaries. As he takes a break, we read that so often, Jesus went up a mountainside. Jesus showed us that we need a break. So in following him, that might mean for us setting something down for a period, for a season, stepping away from the ministry, realizing maybe it just need a break, but at the same time remaining a supportive presence to whoever might step into a new. So this morning, if you're feeling a bit ordinary and unexceptional, good. That's exactly the kind of person that God uses. you for all that you have given us, and we hand it over to you now as we acknowledge that we belong to you. Our time, our talents, our money are yours, and we commit them to you for the uplifting of your name and the growth of your kingdom. We pray for your kingdom, our world, which needs a servant king to wash the feet of those who have forgotten what it is to be touched, the lonely, the forgotten, the ridiculed. We pray for a world which needs a unifier to bring together those who are enemies and those who have been overlooked. Plans for us, plans to give us. take us now and use us to love and serve you and all people in the power of your Spirit and the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.